In the first two events this season, Kim Adler stepped up in the 10th with a chance to be victorious, but came up short both times. Tonight, she hopes the third time's a charm as she's top seed in the St. Clair Classic next. Welcome inside St. Clair Bowl in Fairview Heights, Illinois, for the finals of the St. Clair Classic. Tonight's opening match features former Team USA star Kendra Gaines, last year's runner-up to Player of the Year, Kara Honeychurch, and the 1999 Rookie of the Year, Tiffany Stanbrough. The winner of that shootout will face two-time PWBA champ Tennille Grijalva, and the victor there will challenge top seed Kim Adler for the title. Hello, everyone. I'm Jan Schmidt, along with PWBA's reigning player and bowler of the year, Carolyn Doran Ballard. Thanks for tuning in. Carolyn, the top story this week has to be the scoring pace. It took a 230 average to make the telecast. That compared to a composite average over the last 23 events to make the show of 211. Why the big increase?
After last year, the athletes wanted to see a little bit more variety on the lanes. So our lane maintenance supervisor this week decided to go away from the sport condition and put something different down on the lanes. A regular sport condition is a 2-to-1 ratio, which does not create a lot of buildup in the middle part of the lane. This week we bowled on a 4-to-1 ratio. The buildup in the middle was huge, which created a nice hold area. This led to the 4-800 series and the 4-300 games. If the scoring pace continues, I expect to see a lot of strikes tonight.
Well, the lady that took the biggest advantage of these conditions is top seed Kim Adler.
Kim Adler said last week, "Things are happening for me." She started in 9th position, then led the next 4 out of 5 rounds. She averaged 240 this week. She's ready to win. The top seed has won the last 2 weeks. They have both beaten Kim Adler. Let's see if this week she can keep the winning streak alive from that number one position.
We'll find out in about an hour. Right now, we're ready for the opening match. It's already in progress. Look at the score so far. Kendra Gaines in the lead by 1 pin. We talked about all the strikes so far through 16 frames thrown. Only 2 strikes, Carolyn. Not what we expected to see.
No, I'm a little shocked. But, you know, today's a new day. It's like a new tournament. And the lanes are or have a tendency to be different on show day.
And that's true no matter what conditions put out. As somebody who's on a lot of shows, 18 last year, Carolyn,
right.
Are they different every time you're on practically?
They're always a little bit different. I mean, they might be similar, but very rarely do you get to use the same exact ball. You know, the surface is a little different or your angle's a little different.
Tiffany Stanbrough coming off of 2 splits. One was a tough break, a 6-8 she had left.
One thing that really helped Tiffany this week, she really worked on slowing up her ball speed. She slowed up her approach. She thinks now when she gets on the approach and sets herself up, and it really paid off this week.
Our Honeychurch going for this split, but not enough. So that's her first open frame. She's been in the pocket but unable to carry, having a little bit of footing problem out there getting started this match. And our first look at Kendra Gaines, the only right-hander in this group of three. She also 1 strike only and hasn't carried very well, but
we could be seeing a little more carry down. Back end's getting a little bit tighter. As she lets us know.
Yeah, didn't like that shot, did she? Leaving the bucket, and now Cara stepping up in the 6th. So not what we were expecting, but we will probably see some transition, some change, and hopefully some bigger scores in the next couple of games.
Better shot by Cara. Cara also said during the week that she, you know, struggled a little bit in the beginning of the week and didn't catch on till the end. She just got that one a little. It looks like she went way up the lane, got it inside, but that's what happened this week. The oil is so heavy in the middle that the ball actually deflects away from the head pin. Now she left the bucket and then she missed it, and it's very easy to do this week.
So she was trying to guard against it, hitting that and backing off again, and she missed it to the left.
Absolutely.
So it's now a very, very close match. Kendra Gaines, Cara Honeychurch all even. Tiffany Stanbrough trailing by 11, but she's working on a strike. She can take it down to just 1 if she strikes here. She's right back in this thing.
Tiffany's ready to win her first title. She said last year she didn't make any shows. She was very disappointed in her performance all year, and she worked on some things over the break.
Kendra kind of fall off that shot? She talked about that.
Kendra's coming back from a broken foot late last fall. She says even though it is healed, it still gives her some problems sometimes, and she does fall off her shots. It's going to take a little while to get back into it with that. You know, she's continuing to strengthen it.
And even then, sometimes there's a mental issue where you're just afraid.
You're always going to favor it, absolutely.
Right. Cara Honeychurch going up high. Another split for Cara. TV pair averages on 21 and 22 here. Right-handers at 222. Left-handers 242. But look at the games. That, you know, incorporated a lot more right-handers. Mm-hmm. And a lot of extra games.
And if you just look at average, obviously somebody should have at least 7 or 8 going here. But
they should.
It new day, let me tell you.
And another good run. So on television, it's a different situation. Obviously, there's the pressure, but there's the lights. The warm-up time is different, mm-hmm. different amount of play on the lane. So there's a lot of factors that come into play.
Tiffany making the run.
Tiffany was just waiting for us to come on air.
I think so, too.
Yeah. She didn't care what happened before we came on air.
There's a lot of factors. Also, with the five ladies practicing, you know, some practice more than others. You know, do they practice more on the left than the right? Do you throw a lot of spare shots? I mean, it makes a big impact on how the lanes are going to play.
Kendra averaged 248 on this pair during the week, and obviously nowhere near that now. And you mentioned shooting spares. If you throw a plastic ball a lot in practice shooting spares, that's going to change the carry down on the lane.
Absolutely. It changes everything. Cara moving a little further left on the lane, going a little more direct. She also looks like she's slowed up her ball speed a little bit, get the ball into a roll. She said that was very important for her this week.
All right.
It was very easy to throw it through the oil this week.
Stanbro now in the lead by 10 pins, working on a three-bagger. Three in a row. If she strikes again in the fourth, she'll lead by 20. Getting the fourth one in a row, striking the eighth for the fourth one in a row. She would lead by 20. She qualified third at 233 average. She actually averaged pretty high, but had a pretty low match play record. Only 13, 10, and 1.
She fell off that shot a little bit. Looks like she slipped, pulled up on the shot. Didn't quite finish the way she wanted to. Really helped her this week. Her mom and dad are here, and Roy and Beverly. And she said she likes when they're around. They kind of keep her positive.
Hit.
Kendra going much more direct on that lane. Slowed up her ball speed. Ball finished a little harder, leaving the four pin. She pulled up just a little bit on that shot. Pulled, did not quite finish.
So she has a 3-9, has to guard against the chop. Light ball not getting across. So this definitely is a survivor match to get through this one.
And Kendra shooting at the fourth pin through her strike ball, which in previous weeks we've seen a lot of the ladies throw the plastic ball at their spares because the ball doesn't hook. This week, a lot of ladies threw their regular strike shot at their spares because there was so much oil on the lanes.
Andrew Gaines now in the lead, actually by just 3 pins over Stanbro until that strike.
Can't count out Cara. She just keeps fighting till the very end.
She just evened things up with that strike. So this is going to come down to the wire like we've seen every week.
That was a better shot for Tiffany. She really looks like she's become more consistent with her ball speed. You know, she used to get fast, slow. Now she's gotten it down where she's slow all the time.
Get over there. Yeah.
Big setup shot in the ninth for Kendra Gaines. Parents,
Roy and Beverly. Tiffany also wants to say hi to Uncle Bob at home. She misses him. He usually comes out and travels with them, but he's home taking care of the dogs.
Cara defeated Tiffany in match play this week. is a key shot. Cara Honeychurch tied for the lead in this match with Kendra Gaines.
There we go. And we know Cara's been in that position before to apply the pressure.
She was looking up at the scoreboard. She can strike out for 202.
Keeps it right on line, direct to the head pin, kicks out the seven.
Tiffany Stanbro has to strike here. He gets a big trip for the three pin.
That's a good break for Tiffany, keeps her in it.
One more strike here by Cara Honeychurch will close out Tiffany Stanbro's hopes for tonight.
She kind of liked that shot. She came back, put her head back. She obviously liked what she did with it, but left the seven pin. That's what she said happened to her a lot during the week, though. She kept leaving the weak seven, And, you know, you didn't want to get into trouble with changing too many, you know, maybe too many ball selections. That's how you get into trouble sometimes. So she basically played with her speed a little bit.
So Tiffany coming through at the end, but it's going to be a little short. Cara Honeychurch with a spare here will have 191. The best Tiffany Stanbro can do is 189. So Kendra Gaines will have the opportunity to win this match. She'll have to step up and throw two strikes to take this match from Cara Honeychurch.
Well, Tiffany finished on a good note. She looks good. I hope this year she does a lot better than last year. She's really worked hard on her game.
Well, it was good for her to get back into the telecast. Hadn't made a show since the fall of 2000. And looking for the trip of the two, doesn't get it. Cara Honeychurch will now advance. She will be the winner of this match. Kendra needed that strike and wasn't able to get it. So Cara Honeychurch survives the opener. When we return, she'll advance to the semifinal match, and she'll take on Tenille Grijalva. Final score of match one, Cara Honeychurch 191, the Stanbro's 189, and Gaines 182. Definitely not the shootout we expected. Maybe we'll see some now between Cara Honeychurch and Tenille Grijalva. We're ready for the semifinal match. Carolyn, I know you had a chance to go down and talk and see what was going on the lanes.
Yes, I was very interested to see what was going on down on the lanes. Cara said, plain and simply, she likes the reaction she has. She is not executing. She does not like the way she's coming out of it. She didn't like her finish at the line. So she's just going to really work on executing a good shot.
And that looked like a good execution.
And also, she practiced on the other pair while the other girls were taking their practice shots. She was over there practicing, trying to get into a better rhythm.
First look at Tenille Grijalva. And I like the way she did her hair to match her shirt. Very she said, creative.
She said it's the pirate look tonight.
I guess you can do that if you're 25 years old.
Absolutely, absolutely.
I may try that next week.
Oh, I don't know.
Not a good look for me, huh? Tenille's last show back in October of 2000, she actually won that event, the Hammer Players Championship. She won two majors that year, Hammer Players Championship and the U.S. Open. And since that time has really struggled, 24 consecutive events with the highest finish of 15th.
Yes, and she's not very happy with that. So over the break, she made a few changes on her grip and also did some mental training. But I know probably the biggest change is she put a wrist device on last week. Kendra Gaines, her roommate, helped her out with that. And she likes her ball rotation, and she has seen a difference that has made her more confident.
Actually, 230 average you just saw there, Tenille qualifying second. That was the fifth highest average this week, but she won 18 matches.
And she had a great match play record.
Yeah, put her right up into second.
I asked her what she thought of the lanes. She seems to be playing them a little further right, she said, which could answer the question from the first match. We saw a little carry down. Mm-hmm. But she said she basically is playing the same part, just a little further right, still had a little bit of hold to the left.
There you see those wins. 4-4, 7-1, and 7-0-1. She tied one match in that final round. Everyone seemed to believe the pins, match play pins, 30 pins a game, perhaps more important even on a high scoring event like this.
Oh, absolutely. You had to win those matches, and there were some close ones. I mean, you know, this week it was one of those weeks where you're shooting 269 to 279. You know, 269 usually win by 50. This week you lost by 10.
Cara Honeychurch made the show here at St. Clair Bowl last year, finished up in second, but in the semifinal match she shot 245, so we'll challenge her to at least match that in this semifinal.
She likes this bowling center. She said she enjoys being here. She likes the way her ball rolls here. Very comfortable.
Well, I have a note in that semifinal match. She defeated someone named Ballard.
Yeah.
I think it was you.
Mm-hmm. That's okay. I've forgiven her.
Oh, okay. She averaged 231 qualifying this week.
Actually, she said she was very lucky to be here. She didn't bowl that great all week. She said she'd get to the pocket. Her carry was terrible. She started to play around with some balls but went back to just her ball speed.
Honeychurch up by 10, maximum score possible still, 300 obviously, Grijalva 280, and that's our mini scoreboard sponsored by Travelodge Hotels.
Ooh, she got that one to the right, held right into the pocket, high flush.
Interesting, so she proves to be right so far. It wasn't the lanes, it was really her execution.
And she knows, I mean, she's a field player. She really knows when she is not throwing the ball well and it's not the lane. I mean, she'll look right at you and go, I'm throwing it terrible.
First appearance for Tanil Grijalva this year, as I mentioned, all the way since 2000, the fall of 2000. The best women bowlers in the collegiate and professional ranks come together Sunday, June 2nd as the PWBA Women's Collegiate Pro Doubles Challenge is televised live at 4:30 p.m. Eastern on ESPN. That kicks off a string of five consecutive Sundays of PWBA live on ESPN. So be sure to watch the best in women's bowling on Sunday afternoons. That's beginning this Sunday. Please spend your Sunday afternoons with us. Tanil up now in the fourth frame, trailing by 20 pins.
Tanil is another one of those bowlers where she came out with a lot of experience. She was a Team USA member, a very successful Team USA member, won a lot of international awards, and she had high hopes for herself when she first came out.
Narrowed the margin a bit, but Cara Honeychurch is still in the lead, though it's a close one. We'll be right back with more action from St. Clair Bowl. Back at Fairview Heights, Illinois, there's a look at the Shrine of Our Lady of Snows. Beautiful location. Right now, we're in the sixth frame. Cara Honeychurch will be stepping up in the sixth. She is working on the front five strikes. Seven career 300 games, looking to make it eight. She's already bowled a 300 on television once.
Cara said she was popping up on her shots. She wasn't staying down, and that's what she was really working on. And it looks pretty good so far.
It does. It looks like she has a little bit of room now, and these are the strikes we expected to be seen. So far, 10 strikes out of 12 possible. Tanil Grijalva leaving just 2-4 pins, and the rest strikes. Honeychurch in the lead now by 31 pins.
Cara is a very intense bowler. When she knows something's wrong in her game, she will not leave until it's fixed. Or until she's happy with it. Gets the seven out.
She has to be happy with that. She tripped that seven. It certainly looked like it was going to stand.
Pretty good shot. Kept it right on line. Pin out of the gutter there. Just taps it right out. She's much more solid at the line.
Look at the intensity in her face. She is after this one.
Well, she's had seven or eight in a row on TV before. I think I remember that a couple times.
You think so?
I think so.
Or 9 or 10 or 11 or 12. Tanil, though, still in this match. Like I said, she's been in the pocket just a couple of four pins.
Oh!
A little bit of flop will go a long way sometimes. if we can see what pin. Kept it on line, got it a little bit further right. Pin slides on over and kicks out the seven from behind. Gotta like that. See, now you know things are going your way. Could loosen her up a little bit. You know, she hasn't been on TV in a while. She's a little anxious. And she's bowled well so far.
Trailing now by 41. Strike, take it down to 31. At least momentarily. That strike definitely was for Tennille's nieces and nephews. She wanted to say hello, Ashley, Victoria, Sierra, and Jacob. She's so glad that you support her. They called her right before the show and said, come on, come on, come on.
Well, she yelled stop at that one, and it stopped right in the pocket, and that's what she wanted.
Cara Honeychurch, seven strikes in a row, going for number eight. She also made a run last night in order to make the show, and she told us how she did it.
I was consistently hitting the pocket, but I wasn't carrying enough to be in the top five. So I tried a different ball, a Vortex 2, with a slightly different layout, and it proved to be the difference. Instead of carrying perhaps 40% of the time, my carry percentage went up to about 80 or 90%. That made all the difference.
Well, I'd say her carry percentage this match is obviously about 100% so far.
I think she's using that ball, too, to be honest with you. Cara said that was one of the things she worked on over the break, was learning her equipment better, feeling more comfortable with it.
That's number nine. Definitely no stranger to this. Yes, you did do this once before. She shot 300 at the AMF Gold Cup and won $50,000 bonus at that time.
And you watch her bowl, and she says, I like them when they're tougher. I like tougher lane conditions where I can just spare my way up there. And then you watch her bowl on TV, and she's got the front nine. I think she can bowl either way.
Yeah, she did tell us, and this being Cara, she goes, yes, I can strike with them, but I prefer the grind out. She may change her mind. Great shot. Tennille Grijalva looking really, really good. And That's good for her because she's such a talented lady and just had such struggles over the last year.
Well, you know, like I stated before, she came out, she won. She had a lot of expectations for herself the following year, and boom, she doesn't have a good year. It really got her down. And now she's made a few changes, you know, especially the wrist device. She feels so much more comfortable, and she's so much more confident in her ball roll now.
Well, she told us that for a long time she refused to think it was her on the sport condition, and then she realized, wait a minute, it must be, I need to make changes. And right now she's made some really good changes and really needed that strike. She could have struck out 259 to still have an outside chance.
Seems like she got that one on the lane a little bit, didn't quite catch it as much as she had the last couple of shots. But being open-minded was very important to her the last 2 weeks. She spoke to someone over the break about that, and it really helped her see a little bit of a different view of when she's bowling during the week.
All right. Nice big showing.
Lay you off in the pocket, and I'm telling you, the carry was phenomenal. She had a great showing. The changes she has made have really worked. You know, I hope to see her more this year.
Well, Cara Honeychurch stepping up, getting ready for what she hopes to be a televised 300. Oh, and doesn't trip the six pin. What a great run, the front nine.
A good shot. She stayed with it. Angle was good, right to the pocket. Stubborn six pin.
Carr. Honeychurch wins that semifinal match. We'll be back with you in just a few minutes. Stay with us. We're back at St. Clair Bowl in Fairview Heights, Illinois, just across the river from St. Louis, the home of bowling's heritage. And that's our subject of this week's WIBC Extra Frames. At the International Bowling Museum and Hall of Fame, located in downtown St. Louis, bowlers and enthusiasts alike can enjoy the world's largest collection of items from bowling's more than 5,000-year history. Opened in 1984, the museum displays the entire panorama of bowling's international history, from 3200 BC in ancient Egypt to modern 10 pins. With 50,000 square feet of exhibits, bowling's history is interpreted through a series of interactive exhibits, which shows bowling's successful progress throughout the years. The museum also honors the individual efforts of bowling's legends through several halls of fame, including the Women's International Bowling Congress Hall of Fame, located on the museum's second floor. One of the most beautifully displayed sections of the museum, the Women's International Bowling Congress Hall of Fame, is a glorious tribute to the 138 women whose contributions to bowling are forever etched in the history of our sport. A new addition to this year in the hall is a tribute to the WIBC Recognition Award winners for the past two seasons. Induction into the WIBC Hall of Fame is the highest honor a woman bowler can receive. In 2002, three women were granted the distinguished honor of induction into the WIBC Hall. These women include Nancy Chapman and current PWBA champions Cheryl Daniels and Tish Johnson. So when planning your next trip to the St. Louis area, schedule a visit to the Bowling Museum and Hall of Fame and learn about bowling's heritage. For information, visit bowlingmuseumhalloffame.com or call 314-231-6340. We're honored to have with us some WIBC directors, Betty Hall and Darlene Baker. Great supporters of the tour. Thank you, WIBC. Final score of that semifinal match, Cara Honeychurch 279 to Grijalva's 238. Coming up next, Cara Honeychurch will go up against Kim Adler. She's our top seed. It'll be the championship match. We're back at St. Clair Bowl, and there's the pin that both of these players want to take home tonight. St. Clair Classic champion. It'll be between Cara Honeychurch and Kim Adler. Cara Honeychurch will start the match, and boy, did she get lined up last match.
Just talked to Cara again, and she said it was exactly right. She needs to stay down on her shots. She hasn't changed ball. She hasn't changed lines. It's just being firm at the line that has really helped her. She said, once I raise up, I'm toast.
Okay, we'll watch for that and see if it continues to help her. Well, a little bit high. A little soft actually coming out after the break.
And she was practicing during the break. Raised up just a little bit more than she had been. And maybe threw a little bit slower. She, after the last commercial break, last game she came out, she was very strong, throwing it, you know, pretty firm.
Yes, thank you for that spare. She hasn't had to shoot many spares in a while since that opening match. Here's our first look this week at Kim Adler. Three consecutive telecasts to start the year. Runner-up the last 2 weeks, as you mentioned, Carolyn. She should have the edge, though, as top seed, and she also did pretty well this week. Defeated Honeychurch during the week, and she's defeated her on TV over her career 3-1.
The way Kim bowled, I think she beat everybody. I mean, she bowled absolutely phenomenal. I mean, she bowled great. I mean, she was maybe 140 or 50 over the first round, and then from there, there was no stopping her. Last average last year, 213. This week, 240. I'd say that's an improvement.
Yeah, that's last year's averages.
From everybody.
Mostly on the sport condition. This week, what you're seeing there, those averages compiled by the Ebonite Tournament Coordinator. That's our official tournament software for the PWBA.
One thing Kim did mention, the lanes are playing close to how she had them in the morning block. The only thing she's doing different is she says she's a little further right, and she's using the same type of cover stock with the higher pin to get the ball down the lane a little bit.
Taking a re-rec right now. The other finishers, Kathy Dorn, Lizzie, and Jennifer Swanson, both just missing out by a few pins. Amy Dillon had one of the 800s. Watch out for her.
14th, we have Winnie McPherson, the 1999 champion here, and Tish Johnson, the new WIBC Hall of Fame inductee this year.
Kim now up in the second frame, and I should mention those averages, the comparisons. The first column were the averages from the first 2 weeks this year compared to this week. So it still was a sport average compared to this condition average.
Ball coming in a little light, pin in the gutter, tapping out the 10. Ball deflects off, and pin just taps it right out. After her first two shots, Kim's ball, it might be a little bit weaker. I mean, it is a higher pin. She's been using a lot of low pins during the week.
As we said earlier, second show for Cara, third show for Kim. So these two should be very comfortable on TV this year.
A lot of TV experience out there. I mean, even though Kim didn't make as many shows as she usually does last year, I mean, she's still a very, very good TV bowl. You don't win 14 times, you know, not being very focused.
Well, she's made 100% of the shows this year, Kim Adler, and she only made 9% of the shows last year, which is not normal for her.
And Cara, two out of the first three, she's right on pace.
Match all even right now. Obviously, both ladies could still shoot 290. But again high, leaving the 2-7.
She's shaking her head. I think she thought she threw that one well. That left lane might be breaking down a little bit for her. I think that lane's breaking down a little bit for her. She's going to make the move on the next, should make the move the next time she's up on that lane.
Okay, now interesting here last year, remember I mentioned the semifinal, Cara shot 245. We challenged her to beat it. She did, 279. In the final match last year here, she went to 179. So it went down a lot for her in the championship match.
Great spare.
Kim Adler won this event in 2000. She actually would be the first repeat champion here in the St. Clair Classic.
And she wasn't even aware of that till I mentioned that to her today. She goes, oh my gosh, I couldn't remember that. I said, it may be an omen.
Double for Kim.
Much better shot. She seemed a little more aggressive, slowed down a little bit with that ball, let the ball roll. Great result.
Look at some of our other finishers. Shanna Ray in the cut week after week. Carolyn, you snuck in for a cash there. Kim Torella, 300 and an 800.
And Jen Winkelfleck, local, first top 24 ever.
Good for her.
I said a local. She's from Oregon.
Oh,
but
well.
It's her first top 24. She came out and joined us, and she's going to bowl a couple more weeks. It was nice to see her.
Sue Jeziorski back out bowling, too. I haven't seen her bowl in a while. Adler leading by 10 right now. Looking to take it to 20 with another strike. And she's looking to do it early. She doesn't want another match coming down to the 10th frame like the last 2 weeks.
She wants to apply the pressure quick, have it over by the 8th or 9th frame, and go home with the trophy and the check.
Cara was runner-up to Player of the Year, runner-up to you, Carolyn. In a phenomenal year, actually, in her own right, would have many times been a Player of the Year with the year she had. With 13 shows, 4 victories. And there's that 7 pin again.
Cara could be experiencing a little carry down on her side. We had Tiffany bowling on that, you know, on the pair the first game. She's already, you know, she's into her third game. Could be going through a little transition for her.
Some time on that spare, make sure she covers it, and she does. Cara did a lot of work over the break. Interesting, she has a sponsor, Bowl Australia, and she appeared on a lot of high-profile shows over there in Australia promoting bowling.
Really promoting the sport of bowling. She says sometimes over in Australia they get a lot of coverage on other sports, and she's finally gotten the opportunity to really promote bowling. She just went over to the practice pair and picked up another ball. So let's see what she does on this shot.
nice shot.
Ball looks like it rolls up a little more and rolls a little bit heavier into the pocket. Great shot. Seven pin.
See if we can see some of the differences there. Cara in the third frame. Take a look at her right now.
Seems like it was a good shot. Just hooked on the back end a little bit more than it had before.
And this was her most recent shot with the ball change.
Ball gets down the lane, still rolls. Recovered fern to the pocket.
Kim Adler now up in the fifth frame. She's working on three in a row. Her average on this pair, 242. She bowled three games on it throughout the week. Well, she got lucky and struck. Well, it didn't impact her.
Well.
So four in a row. Apologize, we've had some discrepancy here with the lanes. A lane had re-wrecked on its own, so we were questioning whether Kim Adler should actually make that shot. It was on its second cycle. She did and was fortunate to strike, otherwise it would have swept her pins away. We would have had to have them respotted. So we were just taking a moment to try and figure all that out and make sure everything went according to the rules and everything's fine. Kim's on four in a row, looking for her fifth strike right now. Leaving a 10 pin.
She got that one inside, which she's been doing all week. She said that's the way she played the lanes. Looks like she hit way left of target. Ball doesn't quite finish the way it has been, deflected off a little bit and leaves a flat 10. Tell you though, during the week, that flat hit, that's exactly how you had to play the lanes. I mean, the more you could get the ball to deflect off, I mean, we were throwing pins all over the place.
Kim Adler is in the lead by 31 pins, so stay with us to see if the third time indeed is a charm for Kim Adler. We'll be right back. Kim Adler now in the lead by 21 pins. We're in the middle of the championship match. While we were away, Cara Honeychurch threw a double to reduce that deficit to 21. Kim Adler now in the seventh frame working on a spare. And she gets a strike, a big strike. Carolyn talked to Kim earlier and asked her about this being the last place of her last title.
Well, I love this center, and they're doing a big remodel here starting next week, and all I can hope for is they keep the lanes down. So next year when we come back, I'll have the same surface to bowl on.
I guess she loves it.
She likes this bowling center, but as talented as Kim is, I would think that she'd probably get lined up anywhere else too. But.
Yeah.
You always enjoy the centers where you've won before, you know, the crowd's behind you, and you make friends, so it's a lot more comfortable.
I know she wants that crystal pin because she has a collection she's forming at home, a crystal pin. Kim Adler actually shot a personal best round this week in match play, 406 over, an average of 250.75, but no, that is not the record. The record is an average of 262.12. And Anne-Marie Dugan holds that record. She did it in Omaha in 1995.
My goodness.
That's enormous. Oh. That's crazy bowling.
I can't even fathom that.
Spare for Kim. And we talked about the show this Sunday. Be sure to tune in as Ray Pryor from Granada Bowl in Livermore, California attempts to throw a strike for $25,000 as the inaugural Mega Strike jackpot comes to a conclusion from the Cherry Bowl in Rockford, Illinois. Tune in for that. He'll be coming out making the trip to Rockford for that. Mega Strike is still going on, so talk to your local center. Cara was working on a double. That was the eighth frame. Really, really needed that strike to put some pressure back on Kim.
Looked like she threw a good shot. She kind of ran it out there to the left. She liked the way it was headed. which leaves another flat seven. I think she experienced a little carry down, not kicking the seven out the way she did that second game, because she really is not she only popped up on it that one shot this game. She's basically stayed down, been firm, just not getting the breaks.
Staying clean, though, still trying to give herself an opportunity at the end of the match. Kim Adler not looking, not wanting to see what's going on. So it's a 22-pin deficit for Cara Honeychurch.
Still in this match. Like we said every week, you know, the 8th, 9th, and 10th frames have been very crucial.
Definitely needs to strike, set it up. She could strike out for 227. Kim Adler on a strike spare is at a 229 pace. So she still is in this match.
Another great shot. She definitely made the adjustment on that left lane. She made some really good shots after she changed balls. That is the mark of a true person who knows her game, what she's doing, knows her equipment, and knows how to read the lanes.
Once again, taking her time on the spare. Still important, you never know. I mean, two frames left for Kim Adler. Best Cara Honeychurch could do now is 216. Kim Adler just needs some very, very good count.
Kim defeated Cara in match play there. Maybe she's thinking back to last, you know, when she was there in that position. Wants to do it again.
And as we mentioned earlier, 3-1 against Honeychurch, career television matches.
Another good shot by Kim. Doesn't seem to be getting the flip into the pins she was like she was during the week. Now, like I said, she told me she seems like she got it a little left of target again, which she had been doing all week, but she said she opted to go with a higher pin ball. This could, you know, honestly, the ball might be just a little weak, but she might have felt that it was keeping her in the pocket.
That up. That was a big spare. She's just going to need some pin count here on her first ball. 5 pins, I believe. She needs a mark. I'm talking to Del Ballard, who's scoring here for us.
She's been in the pocket the whole game. If I had to take odds, I would think that she is definitely going to hit the pocket. Kim has been in this position before, especially the last 2 weeks. Is she going to do it?
She needed a double the last 2 weeks. This week, a mark.
It's a repeat performance.
Just looking for that mark. Doesn't need the double. And it's a 10-pin again.
Threw a good shot. All she needs is a spare.
Just glancing over at the score.
Which Kim usually doesn't do. I'm very shocked at that.
Right. Well, if she misses this 10-pin, we could have a tie.
Taking a few extra seconds. Kim is a very deliberate bowler. She takes her time, very meticulous in what she's doing. Took a few extra seconds. It's a big shot.
And that'll do it. Finally, Kim Adler, after 2 tries and a year of trying last year, unable to win, right back on track.
I think she knew before the ball even hit
the pin. She was smiling the minute
pin,
it came off
say.
Her hand.
Right.
That's right.
Exactly. That was good.
Didn't even need to make this shot, but she will anyway. And it's a 9-count, so Kim Adler hits a home run on her 3rd attempt this year. She's the winner here at the St. Clair Classic. We'll be right back with more. There's your champion of the St. Clair Classic, Kim Adler. Final score, 226 to 216. And bringing in the dollars is Trudy Stewart, assistant general manager here at St. Clair Bowl.
Congratulations, Kim. You really bowled outstanding all week long, and you deserve this.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And I know you're particularly anxious to receive this pin coming in. Mike Imes, general manager here at St. Clair Bowl.
Congratulations. You've been on a mission all week. It's been outstanding watching you bowl.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I want to thank St. Clair Bowl again for hosting a wonderful tournament here, WIBC, Travelodge. I'd also like to thank Brunswick, my ball company, for allowing me to throw the balls that matched up so well this week. Everyone here is like a big family to me, and that's the reason why I bowl so well. Thanks again.
Okay, Kim, how did it feel? Runner-up the last 2 weeks. What, did you do anything different, or how did it feel?
Of course I didn't do anything different, but it really felt like a three-week one tournament to me. So it was a very long 3 weeks, so I'm glad to be here.
But a big win. So Kim Adler, the first repeat champion here at St. Clair Bowl. She's your St. Clair Classic champion. Watch for the PWBA live this Sunday at 4:30 p.m. Eastern on ESPN. It'll be the first ever PWBA Women's Collegiate Pro Doubles Challenge. For Carolyn Doran Ballard, I'm Jan Schmidt. We'll see you Sunday. So long from Fairview Heights, Illinois. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com.